We have two speakers tonight who are going to regale us with great tales of students who went to National Park Seminary. Eleanor Doherty and Ginger Nestle are both residents of National Park Seminary, and interestingly, they're both descendants of alums who went here. Eleanor's grandmother and great aunt both attended, and Ginger's mother and her two aunts attended here, so they have a very personal connection to the site. So we're really pleased that they're going to tell us about some of the more famous women who attended school at National Park Seminary and National Park College. Ladies?
I'm Eleanor, and good evening, and thanks for joining us. When we started on this journey, putting this together, we spent a lot of time in the archives looking for accomplished women, and there were so many that we decided to narrow it down, or you would be here for hours, to four women, and so we're entitling this Women in the Arts. But first, a little background. One of the interesting sort of philosophy that I found in the yearbooks and some of the older books was this notion of a well-educated woman. And I have to say, it was progressive for its time. This notion that women should not, it's not a finishing school. This is a school where women are given a rigorous education. And you know, I'm in education, and I hear that all the time today. So it was interesting to see it in books written in 1917 and that era. This quote here struck me as somewhat interesting. It's that the language is so interesting, and it's just this notion that there will be no barriers, that you can pursue your talents, and that there should be a school, a place where you could do this. And you heard that theme all through these yearbooks and in the sort of foreword to other books throughout the era. It wasn't just written in 1917. You saw it again in 1930 in the alum records as well. Okay. Just to show you, I know you can't see this as well, but I'll read some of this. This was the average student daily schedule, and it was a busy, busy day. So just on Tuesday, you started at, oh my goodness, 8:30 in the morning, reciting Latin. Then you studied English, you recited English, you had gymnastics, then you went to piano practice, then chapel and luncheon, then home economics, walk and recreation, piano practice again, study history, dinner and recreation, lecture, study Latin, a lot of Latin, and to bed at 10. And throughout the week, every moment was planned. But there was also this notion that, as you saw in an earlier slide, that you not only study from textbooks, you not only got, you know, book knowledge, but you were also exposed outside to the world outside, and thus we have our famous pagoda and the different buildings around here. So I'm going to turn this over to Ginger, and we're going to alternate throughout the evening. Whoops.
Good evening, everyone. We're happy to have you all here. And you know, as Eleanor said, many graduates who came here when they were here in the 1910s, 1920s, 1930s went on to have careers, which was really not usually expected of women in those days. They were usually expected to marry and have children, and many of them did that as well. But we had graduates who were went in the State Department, who were teachers, and primarily, though, a lot of the people who went here to school ended up in some way of art or entertainment. So as we did our research, we picked out four women who, from the heyday of NPS, to showcase tonight because they really made names for themselves among the wider public, and all in some form of entertainment and building on the foundation fostered by the NPS education and environment. So the women we're going to talk about tonight are Irene Foote Castle, who was here in 1910, Marion Claire Cook Weber, 1926, Margaret Keyes Lindsay, 1930, and Virginia Comus Graham, 1931. Irene Foote, and many of you have probably heard of Irene Castle, she was born in 1893 in New York, and she attended NPS for about a year and a half, and she left in the spring of 1910. In the archives, we really weren't able to find any reference specifically to her time here at NPS, but there was a history of the alumni that was written by an alum and referenced that she was here for a year and a half, and she was a Zeta. She was at the Zeta sorority. But we suspect that she began her dancing career right here in this ballroom. And you'll see that she obviously knew what she was doing. Right after she left, she met and married Vernon Castle. He was a British dancer that was in New York at the time. And they moved to Paris for a couple of years to perform in a dance revue. After returning to the States, they opened a dancing school in New York City called the Castle House, where they taught New York society the latest dance steps during the day and greeted guests and performed at their nightclub, Castles by the Sea, at night. You can see there's a theme here. Oh, sorry. The Castles were instrumental in development of modern dancing. They reached the peak of their popularity in Irving Berlin's first Broadway show, Watch Your Step, in 1914, in which they refined and popularized the foxtrot. They also created their own version of the waltz called the Castle Walk. This clip was filmed in 1939 and obviously is not with Irene and Vernon, but it shows the Castle Walk as developed by them. And you can imagine them dancing right here, just like Dancing with the Stars. And after seeing this, I'm sure all the people who live in the environment are going to be having a petition to have a ball right here, just like that. As the couple's celebrity grew, Irene became a major fashion trendsetter, initiating the trend for women to wear shorter skirts. She's also credited with introducing American women to the bob, the short haircut favored by the flappers in the 1920s. Vernon Castle was a pilot, and he returned to England during World War I and flew missions for the British out of England. He then returned to the States and was teaching pilots, was an instructor, and he was killed on an instruction mission in 1918 when he was in Texas. Irene subsequently remarried a number of times and had a couple of kids. And she starred solo in about a dozen silent films before she retired from show business in 1924. In the 1930s, the castle's life was turned into a movie by the studio RKO called The Story of Vernon and Irene Castle, starring Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers. I've not seen that movie, but I think it would be great fun to get it and show it right here in the ballroom. After retirement, Irene became active as an animal rights activist, founding the Illinois animal shelter Orphans of the Storm, which is still active. She died in 1969 at the age of 76 and was interned with Vernon at Woodlawn Cemetery in California. That's Irene. Now we go to Eleanor.
Marion Claire Cook Weber was born in 1902 in Lake Bluff near Chicago. Marion was the daughter of accomplished parents, her mother a pianist and an organist, and her father a successful lawyer. At the age of six, she played the violin in a children's concert, and she remained a concert violinist until she was 21, and she also studied singing during those years. She attended National Park Seminary and graduated in 1921. After graduation, she continued the study of singing and made her grand opera debut in Italy, singing the role of Mimi in Puccini's La Bohème. For 7 years, she sang with opera companies in Italy, France, and Germany. She also acted and sang in lighter fare. As you see here, she was in the movie, a musical, Make-A-Wish, with Basil Rathbone. Yes, Rathbone. She sang with, worked with, accompanied many famous composers, as you see here. One critic wrote in the Chicago Tribune this description. Othello, she was in the play, was so exhilarated with a featherweight Desdemona, Miss Claire, he lifted her exuberantly, broke one of her ribs, and caused Italians to marvel at the fervor with which she protested that she was being killed unjustly. In 1929, she married Henry Weber of the Chicago Civic Opera Company, who was known as the youngest operatic conductor in America. And now, we would like to present for you Marion Claire Cook Weber. Thank you. A lovely voice, don't you think? Really sounds wonderful in here, too. Would be very nice to hear some other sopranos. In 1947, she became director of WGNB-FM and sang on the Chicago Theater of Air until 1955. She died at the age of 85 in 1987.
Our third famous alum is Margaret Keyes. She was here in 1929 and 1930. She was born in Dubuque, Iowa in 1910. And you know, it's interesting when you look through all the alumni directories and you look through the yearbooks, many, many of the women who came here were not from this area. They were from all over the country, a lot from Texas, a lot from California, obviously Iowa, New York. So it's interesting that the school had such a wide following all over the country. This is her a photo that was taken out of the yearbook in 1930, her senior year. And she was a member of the Alpha Sorority, which was located in the American Bungalow, which, as you know, is in the process of being renovated. And as you can see, that her all of her classmates obviously knew that she was talented because they said, "Peg is a dramatic star whom we all enjoy. Brilliantly she acts her part, whether girl or boy." And she was very active in many aspects of life at NPS. She served as a member of the senior executive board. And she was also president of the dramatic club during her senior year. And when I was looking through the yearbooks, I could see that she had a prominent position in many, many of the theatrical events that they had during the 2 years that she was here. And she often played a male character as well as a female character. After leaving NPS, Margaret, or Peg, depending on how well you know her, I guess, attended the American Academy of Dramatic Arts in New York, and then went to England, where she appeared in live theater. She was often mistaken as being British due to her convincing English accent that she acquired while she was over there in the theater. She appeared in about 80 movies, usually as the other woman, a debutante, a socialite, or the best friend to the heroine or the lead character. She bounced between A and B pictures, playing leads in some and supporting roles in others. Her British accent won her a role as a doomed English bride whose honeymoon takes place on the Titanic in the movie Cavalcade. Written by Noel Coward, Cavalcade won the Academy Award for Best Picture in 1933. Here again, wouldn't that be another fun movie to see here, right here in the ballroom? Her most famous role was in The House of Seven Gables in 1940 with George Sanders and Vincent Price. She played a character called Hezbollah, and I think that the reviews were that if that role had been played, if she did it so well that if her name had been Bette Davis, she would have been, you know, heralded as a wonderful actress, but nobody really knew who. I mean, Margaret Lindsay didn't have the Bette Davis name. She worked with many top leading men, such as Paul Mooney, Errol Flynn, Henry Fonda, Humphrey Bogart, Boris Karloff, and Douglas Fairbanks. And she was cast 4 times as the love interest of James Cagney. This is a clip of Margaret Lindsay in a movie called BJ's Daughter. I tried to get a clip of The House of Seven Gables, but I couldn't, starring Barbara Stanwyck and Van Heflin.
Did you check, miss? Hello, Apples. I'm not late, am I?
That's her right there.
I've just had time to order a drink.
Oh. Well, it looks like a nice place.
All the intellectuals come here. I think it's divine. Well, it's nice, but not divine. And Apples, you must learn another word.
When did you learn not to use the adjective divine for everything?
I beg your pardon?
I almost hear you. A divine car, a divine girl, a divine man. You have precisely the voice for it.
Are you sure intellectuals come here? I'm sorry, Polly. It'll be all right when we sit down for lunch. Now, how about a cocktail?
Your table is ready, sir.
I'm having something new called Blood in the Snow. It's absolutely divine. It's, really very good. Bartender, another Blood in the Snow, please.
Yes, ma'am.
Hey, where's your poodle?
I'm sorry, but we didn't come here to be picked up.
You ought to be walking with one of those cinnamon-colored poodles cut to look like an Airedale. Probably named Sasha. I guess they're poodles.
Well, you ought to know. You look like a professional dog walker yourself.
She's clever, isn't she? I like a girl who can take care of herself.
Bob said he didn't approve of two girls lunching alone in a speakeasy. Maybe he was right.
Well, of course Bob was right. Whoever Bob is, I don't approve of two girls having lunch alone in a speakeasy either. I think it's a terrible idea. If you belonged to me, I'd absolutely forbid it.
I'll bet you would.
Of course I would. Now, if you had lunch with me, you wouldn't be alone, would you?
Look, I guess you didn't hear what Miss Fulton said. We did not come here to be picked up.
Fulton. My name's Brett. Tom Brett.
All right, Mr. Brett, this is Miss Sandler.
How do you do? Well, now that we're all old friends, let's see. I'll go ask Luigi to cook up some of his special spaghetti. It isn't very good.
Apples, do you mind? I've never met anyone quite like this joker. Of course I don't mind, darling, only...
Only?
Well, if I had Robert Tasman in my pocket...
Oh, don't be silly, darling. I'm suggesting we have lunch with him, not marry him. Come on.
All right.
And if anybody's interested, the drink Blood in the Snow, which I had never heard of before, was popular in the 1920s, 30s, when people really drank real whiskey. And it's composed of a concoction of whiskey, vermouth, brandy, curacao, and maraschino cherry juice, all poured over chopped ice. Just in case you want to have a Blood in the Snow. Then you can walk later. In the 50s and 60s, Margaret made her way to TV, and she played in a role in The Importance of Being Earnest, which gave her a chance to once again display her British accent. Margaret Keys never married, and it wasn't clear. I couldn't really quite figure out when and where she added the name Lindsay. I guess it just, you know, how Hollywood is. It sort of rolls off the tongue better. She was romantically linked to a number of actors and actresses, and including William Gargan, Edward Norris, Janet Gaynor, and Mary McCarty. She died at age 71 in 1981 and is buried in California.
And last but not least, our famous woman in the arts is Virginia Graham, but known here as Jenny Comis. And this is a picture of her in her junior year. She was born in 1912 in Chicago on, I quote, a suffocatingly hot July 4th. Now, how do I know that? Because she wrote an autobiography. One of the life facts she writes about in her autobiography. And she goes on to say, suddenly my mind ranged back to my childhood, a little Jenny Comis, the child who used to sit and look at everybody, and I could hear Papa saying to me, Jenny, your eyes are going to burst from all that seeing. They're getting so big, they're swallowing up your face. Jenny must have been a hoot here at NPS. She was voted the wittiest in 1930. She wasn't here for long. She was here briefly in 1930 for a year in 1931. But she went on to get a degree from the University of Chicago. in anthropology at the age of 18, and she later earned a master's in journalism from Northwestern University. Besides being the wittiest, she was clearly a lover of words, and she was a poetess here at the this is from the National Park, her days at the National Park Seminary. They're a little romantic, but I think they're pretty good for those days. Now, Virginia was best known as a host of radio and television talk shows that ran from the 1950s through the 1970s and are considered forerunners of today's daytime television programs. And I think if you ever, if you're pushing the remote and you see some of that, those daytime talk shows, I think there's one called Girl Talk today. You really can see that her influence on those shows. She started in radio in the 1930s as host of Weekday, and later Food for Thought from 1956 to 1961, but she was best known nationally for a nationally syndicated television talk show, Girl Talk. And that's why I thought about that connection on ABC. And I think I vaguely remember this from 1963 to 1969. And the Virginia Graham Show from 1970 to 1972. And we would like to give you a little clip here of a interesting moment in one of her talk shows.
And now, Virginia Graham answers her mail.
Today's letter is from Miss C.S. And Mrs. C.S. has a problem with her husband. He hasn't been coming home at night and giving her the marital devotion that she feels is necessary. She has lived with him for several years, and she feels that this is an indication of perhaps a sterility or a desire to have love. Now listen, Mike Walsh, you have been doing this too long. I have got to explain to you that he is an impossible person and has been on the air, and I don't, and I have promised that I wouldn't do it anymore.
Virginia,
so
dear,
yes,
I'll take care of it. We're going to take a cutaway now, and then we'll come back in just a moment.
No, I will continue. And I'll continue talking. Now, I'm very sorry. I think maybe we ought to go to music, and I'll come back and I'll do my last later.
Time for an advertising break. In those days, right, you weren't taped. Well, she must have been quite a delightful person. Dan Rather, who worked with her on Weekday, said she was shrewd in a lovely way. Besides radio and television, Virginia also starred in Chicago, in a Chicago production of Neil Simon's Barefoot in the Park, and wrote several books, including Life After Harry, My Adventures in Widowhood, and I Love Antiques, But I Don't Want to Be One. In her autobiography, There Goes What's-Her-Name, The Continuing Saga of Virginia Graham, television's brightest personality tells her own funny, sad, and moving bestseller story, and all that on one cover. She writes in a chatty tone, not gossipy, but does reveal some of the characters in her life. In her career, Virginia interviewed many celebrities, including Betty Davis, who she described as forthright and often too honest, and Agnes Moorehead. Her presence at the table would be an instant success because by her tone, her voice, the way she talks, she makes an absolute rhapsody out of "Please pass the peas and butter." That was Agnes Moorehead. Virginia married theatrical costumer Harry Gutenberg and was survived by a daughter. During her professional career, she lived in New York until her death in 1988. And now the most important people in my life who went to the National Park Seminary, my grandmother Penelope and her sister Annie Louise Alexander. They were here between 1914 and 1960. They were from Fort Worth, Texas. There were quite a few Texas girls here. In fact, my 92-year-old cousin of my grandmother, who lives in Fort Worth, remembers the National Park Seminary. She went to the Mount Vernon Seminary down the road. I didn't hear a lot about National Park Seminary. She talked about going to school in Washington, but she never told me where in Washington. I knew it was a girls' school. So when I came to look at a unit here, I didn't know she went here. I actually thought she went to National Cathedral. It was the only sort of girls' school I knew of. But it didn't take long for me to figure it out, and then I went into our boxes of letters and pictures, and I found this. And of course, it says down there in her handwriting about my Annie Louise's graduation date, 1914. So it's a pleasure for me to walk up the steps here at Senior House, and I see that class plaque. And I know they're both here in spirit.
And as Ann mentioned at the beginning, my mother, who's the woman who's in the middle, and her twin sisters, who were 14 months older than my mother, were here in 1930 and 1931. They graduated in 1931. They were local. They lived in Chevy Chase. They grew up in Chevy Chase. So they were really among the rarities of people who really came from the area to go to school here. And because they were only 14 months apart, they really went all through their school years as if they were triplets. So they all were in the same class. They went to Sidwell Friends before they came here. And they graduated in 1931. Unfortunately, as I was growing up, and I didn't really pay much attention to where my mother went to school. It's a cautionary tale for people who still have relatives that they can get information from about where they went to school. They were both here. The three girls, the three Hoover girls, as they were called, were members of Alpha, the American Bungalow. So I'm sure they knew Margaret Keyes. I'm sure they knew Virginia Graham or Virginia Comus. I don't have any of that rich history about, their interaction and,
keep talking.
Now that I live here, like Eleanor was saying, you have the sense of history here, and I do hear my mother sometimes say to me when I'm walking out the door, "You're going out wearing that?" But it's a wonderful place to live and to get a sense of the history of my family and all the other families who are here. And that's the end. Thank you all very much. And Eleanor and I would be happy to entertain questions. I must make one edit to my statements about Irene Castle. In my glee to try to get the ballroom used more actively, I sort of fudged a little on the dates because the ballroom wasn't built when she was here. But we could still imagine her dancing the castle walk here. Bonnie told me that. Bonnie corrected me, as Bonnie is a wont to do. So any questions for either of us?
You have more of these women. I want to see more.
Well, actually, these were the most famous ones that we could find stuff on the internet about. There's a woman named Louise Morgan, who I found, who was a broadcaster in Boston. She was named Massachusetts Broadcaster of the Year in, I think, the 1950s. and trying to research more information about her wasn't successful. But now that we've sort of put our toe in the water with this, Eleanor and I will redouble our efforts.
We found women who'd been statesmen, a Jan Thompson who'd served with the as a secretary of state. It was something like that, not secretary of state, but ambassador of state, and many women who served in the Red Cross, particularly during the war, and were nurses and teachers. So it was a long list of professions. It was just harder to find images and clips, of course, of them. But the women who went here certainly pursued, if not full-blown careers, they were involved in their communities and even wider communities beyond their local communities.
Yes, yes. I knew that my mother had been a student here when I bought here. And I'm trying to troll through my cousins and try to see if any of them have information. So, you know, I've gotten information out of the yearbooks and they were here, but the personal stories and things are things that unfortunately we don't have. Well, thank you all. We're going to be planning next year's, as Anne and everyone on the board, next year's educational program. So we hope that we will see you all again. And don't forget, we can always use your money for the sculpture fund. And we would love for you all to become members. Thank you.